Hey, my name's Tony Ray.
This is Donatelli.
I'm Pappy.
And I'm Sunshine.
And this is Strange Tales.
Strange Tales?
And you are listening to Strange Tales from Outer Space.
Let's start the show.
Yeah.
Welcome to Strange Tales from Outer Space. We're blowing minds right now.
Thank you for saying minds.
Oh no, we are. I already blew. You know what? I'm not gonna.
It's you can't stop at blue. Have you not learned anything? You have to say something after blue.
I don't know. I've seen a lot of cool blues, like Blue the Raptor, Blue My Boy,
Old Man Blue.
Oh, you mean Old Man Blue? Old Man Moose.
Old Man Blue. Old. That doesn't have blue in it. You missed the point of the joke. You started missing the point of the joke.
Anyway. Welcome to Strange Tales from Outer Space. Welcome to Strange Tales from Outer Space. We are a weekly Wildstar podcast that gives you the news and the views from the planet Nexus and beyond. This week, my name is Doc. I have with us two... I almost forgot to introduce myself there. I have two awesome co-hosts, Krug.
Hi, my name is Krug, and I know my name. And it's my name every week. It's not just this week. Krug is my name every single week.
And Clover.
I don't know why they keep inviting me on this podcast.
Because you're a part of Q-Times and it's really easy.
She's also really knowledgeable and opinionated.
I try.
So last week, I wasn't here. This week, it is Indigo's turn. He is busy taking care of some work stuff, so I do apologize if you came in looking for his boyish face, because he's creepily boyish. Like, doesn't have... It's just... It's weird. He looks like a child. It's so odd. Anyway.
It's not his fault.
No, it's not. Sucks for him as a stroke of my beard. Anyway,
oh my God.
Krug, how was your week this week?
My week was great. Excuse me. Let me clear my throat a little bit.
You've downed like 4 Red Bulls in a row.
Yeah, right now I'm super hyped up on energy drinks. I have had a 5-hour energy and I'm 2/3 of the way through this monster. And it was a horrible choice. I don't know why I did this to myself.
That crap is not good for you.
I am shaking in my boots even though I'm only in socks.
I'm waiting for like the alien moment where it's just like... Right, your heart palping right out your chest.
Yeah, show us your best imitation of the Strain emote.
I can't, because the only time I've ever seen the Strain emote happen, it was on a macro, so I can't like twitch that quickly. So I don't think that's gonna happen. My week was good. A lot of work. Not a lot of video games until the thing that we're gonna talk about for a majority of this podcast happened, which is the PTR went live, and I played that for a bunch. And that was really good. I have a lot of stuff to say, and I think we all have a lot of stuff to say, so I'm going to cut this short, and we're going to keep going. Next. Boom.
Clover, boom. How was your week?
My past few weeks have been so busy with work. The summer festival and con season, I've been doing a lot of traveling, a lot of selling, so yeah, finally got back into Wildstar after like 2-3 weeks of barely logging in. Shame on me, I know. And the Pokemon World Championships is in Boston in like another couple weeks, and I'm totally gonna go because it's like 12-year-old me is having a beautiful spaz over it.
That'd be really cool to see actually live. I like any kind of tournaments, really.
I can get hyped. It's gonna be great, and I'm gonna buy way too many plushies, and it's gonna be a good time.
What was it? Pachirisu hype? Pachirisu hype?
Yes, Pachirisu.
Pachirisu hype, the boss, man. If you know what we're talking about, go look for the most recent Pokemon World Championship doubles, and you'll understand why Pachirisu is a boss.
And why Seijin Park is really, really good at what he does.
Are you taking a selfie live?
No, somebody's telling me I have something in my hair, but I don't see it, so...
I don't know what I'm talking about.
Keep going.
As for my week, I was gone a week, and the reason why is I took the Jelly Bean to Disneyland. We went, and I took my sister and my nephews and my cousin and my daughter. We ran through the whole park. They got to see a sneak peek of Ant-Man because they haven't seen it yet. And the whole day they were running around saying, "I can shrink," and they'll like jump in a curled a little ball and then pop up, and they'll...
Oh, it's cute.
It was super cool. They're like 5 years old, so they had a ton of fun. As for myself, we've been shopping for school supplies and whatnot, and my tablet died again for the fourth time, and I think that's the last time. I'll give it to Wacom. The tiny bamboo tablet that's like 4x6 note card size, that thing's lasted me for 5.5 years.
Wow.
So I'm
kind of stuff tends to last a really long time.
Yeah, and I've only had to replace a nub once besides that. So I'm a little sad that everything's dead, especially since I got back into streaming, drawing, and stuff like that again. But I'm glad I'm back. I'm glad that the school year is coming up for the first time. I'm going to be a first-time school parent, so I'm excited for that.
Oh, nice. That's exciting.
So
big milestone.
So that's
is it kindergarten or first grade?
Kindergarten. She's super excited for that. So it's interesting. I feel old.
You are. Hey, I forgot something about my week, which is I have a thing for Indigo for how Indigo's week was that I have to read to the Strem. Indigo says, I don't love our viewers enough to write something here myself, even though I can do it from my phone. So Krug wrote this here instead. Just kidding, Indigo. We love you. I'm still reading this out loud on stream. Love, Krug. That's how Indigo's week was. So just in case y'all wanted to know, that's how Indigo's week was.
Well, Indigo, we love you too.
There we go. We'll give him one little. There you go. Oh,
that looks good when you do
for
it.
You.
Tiny little heart.
Oh. You're terrible.
Anyway, let's get into the meat and potatoes of this podcast. For first and foremost, if you had any community event stuff going on this week, we are truly sorry because there will be no room to get into it because we just all had PTR come and just dump its entire it opened the gates and the flood just wiped us all out.
Here was all the community news, and here's what we did.
Just gone to the flood, just completely gone. So, first things first, we all three have been on PTR some way, shape, or form this week, correct?
Yes, sir, we have.
Cool, so we have a little bit of experience in it. We have different opinions, we have some similar stuff, but we're going to go and give you as much hard facts as we can. I actually have my PTR up right now in case I need to do some on-the-spot corrections. So, first and foremost, Wildweave, Idesinia, Moose, Dathorok, Lecky Yee, you guys are insane. When the PTR was open, Moose gave me a message and said, hey, it's open. I may have switched some work things around to start recording stuff, and I'm recording stuff like mad. I go home, I start trying to render it, and I already see Wildweave, Idesinia, Moose, Lecky Yee. There's like 20 million posts from all of you. Why do you make my job so hard?
And I know for a 100% fact that one of those people has a job. So I don't know where all this time's coming from, but you people amaze me.
But impressed.
Being in the right place at the right time.
Apparently. Exactly.
So thank all of you guys. I'm not going to give names for stuff like that. Just assume that if I'm giving you something, a link or something, it's from either Wildweave, Idesinia, Dathorok, Lecky Yee, or someone else. Those guys just went beyond the Call of Duty this week and getting all the PTR stuff on here for us. So first and foremost, the huge news is Attunement is gone?
Nope. Don't tease people like that. Don't tease people like that.
It's different.
It's different and
it's streamlined.
Very, very streamlined.
It was butchered into tiny, tiny pieces, which is exactly what needed to happen.
Which also has some interesting questions being raised about it. So Attunement pretty much got shrunk from a 10-step, right?
12-step.
12-step.
It was a 12-step.
It was a 12-step program.
This one admit you have a problem reading.
I can't believe we've never made that joke before. That's astounding.
I'm glad that joke's even here.
I just got that off the top of my head.
Hi, my name is Doc, and I can't read.
Hi, Doc.
So the new Genesis key has a major change to it. It only has a few options. Step one, get the key. Obviously.
Yes.
Step two is the Bronze Age, so complete all of your dungeons with a bronze minimum. Step three is Over the Gorge. Take you and your group into Kel'Varath and kill the optional Kel'Varath boss. Pretty much you're done after that. You're in Datascape. Congratulations. Welcome to raiding. Get ready to get your butt kicked.
Hold on. Yeah, that's three steps to get
the last step before you could get into GA.
Right.
Yep. But if you want to get into Datascape, you have one more step to you, and that is Omnipotent, which is kill Omna in GA.
Right. But you're in GA. After three steps, you're in GA.
Yeah.
Which is super fucking cool.
It's the end of it, and now you're officially in Datascape. And I think that means like 90% of everyone who is trying to get into Attunement is essentially done.
Most people that are 50s are done.
Yeah.
Like, I would venture to say that. A majority of people who have level 50 characters are done with Attunement. Or with enough to get it into GA. At least.
Which also means, you know, reputation stuff kind of goes off to the side because people are going to really be doing rep grinds for just the optional stuff, like pets and other little random bits of armor and housing, which is really cool. Some people will say that makes it irrelevant. Adventures are kind of gone, too, from that step. No one quite knows what's going on with them at the moment. Dungeons obviously don't change, but the major thing people have been curious about and complaining about, or some way, shape, or form, is world bosses. World bosses are not gone. They've not taken them out of the game. They've taken them out of the step for attunement, but there's been an interesting change with them on PTR. So, as of PTR right now, if you take down a world boss, it has a 24-hour timer on it. Okay, no problem. It's pretty consistent when that world boss is coming up. Obviously, some exceptions will be probably Scorchwing because of the contract. A lot of those world bosses have now become contracts themselves. But there's a new terminal near the world boss that allows you to summon it if you have the correct regents or reagents, whatever you prefer as a term.
Reagents, because that's how it's pronounced correctly.
It's reagents.
Yeah.
But yes, there is a reason to still go after the world bosses. Not only are they a nice, fun challenge, they're going to be hopefully less buggy, because we all know there are some issues with King Honeygrave and with Zoetic and with a few others. They're no longer integral, but they have a reason to go after them again. And KDM in chat just says right now, we changed the Scorchwing contract. Scorchwing is now considered a world boss in the Israel contract. Israel. So, Israel. Yeah, sorry. I always pronounce some of the names wrong. It's really weird. So, I don't know if when you summon it with the timer, it resets the timer. So, like, if you summon it, then kill it, the 24-hour timer starts there. Or, say if it's been killed, then the summoner is used to summon it, if that original timer still keeps ticking. No one's really tested that part yet. No one can really confirm it yet that I've known. So that's kind of the big step and changes with attunement. So, welcome to Genetic Archives!
Do we know what the reagents are for summoning the world bosses? I actually didn't go find that out yet.
There's an imager link that we have.
Yeah, it says they're called progenitor access particles, but for the life of me, I couldn't figure out how to get them.
Yeah, it doesn't say if they drop off anything. Most likely, they'll probably be drops from creatures in the area. So you and your group of friends go and kill a few things. Basically, as you're doing dailies, since a lot of world bosses are tied to dailies.
That's not guessing.
So is it essentially like Hellroll's Bowl then, where you have to go and get stuff and start it up?
I want to say that, and KDM does come clarify and says, hey, it's not too bad. It'll be difficult for a single person to do reagents. If a big group does do it, it'll be pretty sane and pretty quick. So. And even then, the requirements aren't a whole lot. Only 75 reagents to summon a world boss. If you get a group of 20 people minimum to kill a world boss, that's pretty cake.
That's not bad.
Yeah, it's not bad at all. Shouldn't take much more than like 10 minutes.
Guessing. Super guessing. Doc has no idea. Doc has no idea how long it'll take.
Once again, we are on PTR, so take everything we are saying with a grain of salt, because prices aren't completely set yet. Rune types aren't completely set yet. Not everything is set in stone. They're subject to change. Everyone's giving feedback on the forums and on subreddit. So keep that in mind.
I do hope the world bosses get more than just titles and stuff associated with them. I would love if they dropped costumes or housing stuff more. You know, who doesn't want to put, you know, the heads on their wall?
That'd be fun. Or like if you took down Kragar, you actually had like a Kragar shoulder piece. Like you
That'd
just
be neat.
Okay, I like Kragar's shoulder. It's now on mine.
I mean, people are nuts about costumes anyway, and you want more incentive, especially now that it's not part of attunement, other than just, yes, there's going to be people achievement hunting anyway. That's what I've been doing before the, thank you, KDM. They got some love, and that's all she's going to say. You don't know what, but it's there. Who wants to go hunt world bosses on PTR?
Right?
See, and that's the thing I'm worried about, because I understand that you and, like, the people you play with are into that stuff, but I wouldn't venture, if I were to venture a guess, I would say that most people aren't actually that super into putting in that much time to get housing stuff or costume stuff. Like, those kinds of rewards, I think, are less of an incentive than good gear or good or some kind of progression. So I'm a little worried about the population of the groups.
Yeah,
it definitely does.
A lot of housing.
I like get bored and say, I want to have this awesome costume to go raiding with next week. I need to go get something from blah, blah, blah.
Perfectionists want to have all the kill credits so they don't have to have anything sitting there in their achievements that are just missing.
Like, maybe it's just the people that I
you're also
spend
spreadsheet
time with.
Boy.
I'm not into the whole, like, min-max thing. Like, look at my builds. They're not min-maxed at all. Jesus. God, look at my builds. That is proof enough.
Cool part is the attunement part is not the only thing happening in PTR. We're going to go through all of these and give our opinions as much as we can. We actually got a cash shop tour, and I'm also having the cash shop on me as well, live in game, to help correct some stuff. So you'll see a few things, and we'll go through them at the moment, and let me hop in to double check this. You go into the cash shop, it's in your lower left-hand corner of the screen, a giant end coin shows up, it gives you, hey, a featured thing, come check out this awesome stuff. It gives you an option to sign up for signature status if you are not a signature player, and it even tells you what you get, which is really cool and nice. You get to see your loyalty program in the upper left-hand corner, and then next to that, it actually gives you your current account balance of end coin, which has a little hexagonal N there, and Omnibits, which is one of many new currencies. Now, Omnibits, they drop off surprisingly frequently than you think, surprisingly more frequent than you think they do. Now, I played a little bit as a brand new level 1 character, and I've been kind of leveling as much as I can, and I'll tell you a little bit about that later. But I've noticed that it has roughly a 10% chance, and I could be wrong, to drop off of normal kills. They don't ever seem to drop off of completing a task quest that often, but they almost always seem to drop off when you complete a zone or world story quest. And never a whole lot. Maybe one when you're killing things. I think I only ever saw 2 or 3 max when I completed a zone quest, but I could be totally off on that.
Yeah, I don't think I saw more than 2 or 3 at a time from a quest turn, and it seemed completely random too. Like, you just get them every so often.
It's not a super high chance, and if I'm not mistaken, there are customizables flasks. If you go into flasks, you have flasks for harvesting stuff, you have flasks for reputation stuff, you have flasks for resetting your experience. No flasks for increasing Omnibit drops, so you don't have to worry about that. You actually do have quests to help you out with the gold you get and the currency of renown you get, which is nice. So that's kind of cool as well.
And I think the Flask of Riches does everything. It renown, prestige, money, whatever it is.
Yeah, I was going to say, good luck naming off everything. All the currencies there, Clover. Have fun with that.
Yeah, it just says increases currency, renown, and prestige by 25% for
X
amount
of currencies.
Yes, we do.
So many currencies. Why? And there's different potencies of it, which is nice as well.
We have more individual currencies than I have any one currency. Like, that's how many currencies we have. We're too many currencies.
Pretty much. But everything seems, and obviously prices aren't set in stone, but I'm looking at the Hollow Wardrobe stuff right now. You can unlock services like the new Service Coin, another new currency, or Fortune Coins, another new currency.
Yes, they are not listed in your little currency tracker thing, but that's what they are. They are currencies.
So many currencies. Why?
It's because Nexus is a world, okay? Think of how many currencies are on the planet Earth. It's probably actually less than Nexus, but
yes,
still.
But I use euros to get a haircut.
Just did a lore thing. I'm so proud.
Just did a lore thing. Spreadsheet boy has a soul.
Shut up, jerk.
So, hey, I noticed since it just came up on the screen for the lovely 30-second stream lag here, so there's a section that has dyes, obviously, because we knew dyes were going to go up on the cash shop.
Mm-hmm.
Any chance that those previews are actually going to show what the colors look like? Because the two they have on the cash shop now are a topographical map, which is a gradient of like green to blue, and Neapolitan, which is like, you know, for like strawberry vanilla chocolate ice cream. It's that mix of white, brown, and pink, which you would think looks really bad. It's actually really nice.
Yeah, the static images look funky. In actually,
it's just one color, and I'm assuming it's a placeholder, and some poor person in the UI department is going to have to draw those. Yes, Cadium confirms that's going to change. Yeah. Woe to the person in that department who has to draw all the little thumbnails of every dye gradient. I'm sorry.
That person's in a world of hurt. So I want to go over back to these three additional new currencies. I said three because there's one we haven't talked about yet, which, whatever. So there's Fortune Coins.
Welcome to the Strange Tales from Outer Space episode entitled Currencies, where we try to go over PTR, but can't because we have to talk about 45 different currencies that are in the game.
Economics 101.
Welcome to Economics 101. Personal Finance 101. I'll be your Professor Krug. I'm going to teach you how to lose all your fucking money.
As you actually, if you look at your UI when you jump into the new game update right now, there'll be a Lop Fortune Coin right next to the NC Shop Cash Coin. Click on that, it takes you to a brand new screen, and if you ever played Hearthstone, it acts very similarly. You'll see the Lop right here, which will explain you can buy Fortune Coins only with Endcoin. You cannot buy Fortune Coins at the moment with anything else. You can actually see what kind of items show up from this fortune, and a lot of it is specific only to the fortune coin. Case in point, the Protostar Spider Rider mount is only available through the Fortune Teller. Some pets like Minimar from the Fortune Teller. There's some housing stuff from there. There's service tokens, which we'll get into a little bit. Once you buy them, you unlock them, and you even have on your right side a meteor that fills up, and every time you purchase something. At max level, you're actually guaranteed special rewards that will happen. So the more time and money you spend on fortune coins, you'll get more random chances to get cool stuff, but there's more guaranteed random chances to happen.
Now, once you fill up that meter and you get your guaranteed rare thing, does it reset? I'm assuming it does.
Yes, it does.
Okay, I didn't have enough to get all the way through.
Yeah, the meter she's talking about is a little carrot on the right-hand side.
Yeah.
The little carrot thing.
What was the stream? I think it was either Pap or Donatella talking about temperature gauge thingy.
It's
thermometers.
It's a thermos. It's a thermos. It just fills...
Chat says, yes, indeed, it does reset.
Yes, it does indeed you do.
Which, that makes sense. So, you know, because I know some people who are like, oh man, I got the mount on the first try, and some people had to get it all the way to the top, and then still supposedly didn't get the mount.
Yeah, Indigo had a lot of, like, really horrible, horrible luck with this thing. He and I were doing it at the same time, just, like, dumping coins into it. And I had awesome luck. Like, the stuff I got in the PTR was super cool. One of the things that I got that I thought was super interesting was you can have guards at your house. Like,
those are great.
Yeah,
NPCs.
Yes. They don't not interactable and they don't fight. Like, Indigo and I were really hopeful that if we started dueling in front of them, they would start shooting us, because that would be hilarious. But that didn't happen.
They just kind of stand around and
Do have the idle animation, which makes them gives them a little more life. They're not like statues; they don't stand perfectly still. They have the little bounce to them, and they like sway their guns, which it's really cool. And you can scale them like anything else. So I got one of the elite Granite guards, and I scaled him as big as he could go.
They said that's a bug, and I hope they don't fix it.
Is it really? No.
I think it was Young War Chief on Twitter was saying, I thought we fixed that. I'm like, no, it's not a bug.
Damn it! Who reported that bug? You're rude. Don't.
You've ruined it for all of us.
You've taken away my favorite feature.
So
it's not patched yet. It's fine.
No. See, look, we're saying here on the podcast, it's fine.
Yeah, just
feedback. It's totally cool. Just leave it as it is.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna move on to the next little new currency, and that's service tokens. It's kind of odd at first glance what you think that is. You assume, oh, it's tied to getting service from Carbine. It's not.
No.
Service tokens are specific currencies for the chop shop. So your customization. There, you can manage rune slots, so you can reroll and unlock them with it to recover runes. Bypass timers for your cooldown for waking up at a place. You got your recall place, at rapid transport, and a few more. So basically, they're quality of life coins on top of customization coins.
There was an MMO that had like energy, where you can only perform like certain crafting actions or certain harvesting actions. Do you guys know the MMO I'm talking about?
Oh, that was.
I don't know off the top of my head.
Anyways, hate to put you on the spot like that.
It's gonna bother me. No, I know this. Hang on.
Well,
Arcage.
Yeah. Yep. So it's kind of like Arcage's system where if you don't have this, you can't do something. But instead of not being able to do it, you just have to wait. So you can use your housing recall the same way you could before, and then it goes on cooldown. But if you want to use it again, you can just pay service coins and use it. Same with everything else.
And you can still technically do all these things. Like, people remember when the Hollow Wardrobe first went live and all of your costume stuff got returned to you. If you had any of it died or anything else, you would get these little tokens that would allow you to essentially re-dye all of your stuff for free. Service tokens can do that, or you can pay gold, or there's things like the new rapid transport. You can use it once an hour, I believe, and if you want to use it more than that, you either wait or use a service token. And right. I'm sure people for rune crafting are going to freaking love them.
Yeah,
and for those of you that don't know really quick about rapid transport, if you bring up your map and go into a continent view, you see little like spaceships all over the map at certain, I think it's at every taxi location, whether you've discovered them or not.
Every allied taxi station.
Correct, yeah, every allied taxi station.
And a few, it's not just taxi stations, there's actually anywhere that was kind of like a major or minor questing hub.
Fair enough.
Like, there's certain places in Algaroth where there were no taxis, but I noticed you could just go boop right there.
There did seem to be a whole bunch of them, but I think maybe just the ones I clicked on were taxi ones, coincidentally.
Active hubs of questing.
Yeah. So there just places you'd want to go. And then you can just click on the map without leaving wherever you are. You don't have to go find a specific location to travel from. And then it'll teleport you there and cost money.
It does have a cooldown, though.
But it does have, like we said, a cooldown that you can bypass spending a different kind of money. Because money.
It also, I think that actually alleviates a lot of the pressure of having to roll a scientist.
Yep.
So it's because people would always have a scientist. He summoned me here. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, everyone, we're going to go fight Zoetic to get our world boss title.
Yep.
Everyone go over to World of Run. Before it was like, hey, I need a scientist to send me over here. Now it's like, no. Just take the most recent rapid transport to Wilderun and just run over here. We'll see you guys in a little bit.
Yep.
Yeah, by the way, guys, scientists on the PTR have confirmed that the summoning bug has been fixed. So no more exploiting that.
It wasn't a bug. It was an unintended feature.
No, that was definitely a bug.
Well, now that it's fixed, why don't you explain what that bug was?
For those well, we can't because people can still exploit it here on live.
I don't have a scientist, so I don't know how you did it, but I know
how to do it.
I know what it does, which you can basically summon endlessly without having a cooldown.
Endlessly is just rapidly.
It was very good for Hell Rose Bowl.
Very.
Sorry.
Every time people
come, it's like, whoops. I just admitted to cheating.
I didn't do it.
Like, I just know someone who did.
If you guys remember high school, how a lot of high schools were like, you can't wear hats in school, and people wear hats anyway. Yeah. The scientist bug was kind of like that. Everyone said, yo, you shouldn't have used the scientist bug, and then everyone kind of turned a blind eye because it got everybody to the area as fast as possible. This time, it's just, no, use rapid transport, walk over there. If you really need the scientist to summon you over there, he'll do it, she'll do it, but it has a 60-minute cooldown.
Yeah.
There's one more currency we got to talk about, and I am fucking livid at it. Anyone ever played Guild Wars 2?
Nope.
So,
I know what this is because of all my friends who play.
So, there's other games have an option for this, but there is an item on the cash shop, and you'll get it as a reward somewhere along the line. They'll drop, and you can buy them as well. You'll get a key. That key, according to the game, says you can use this key to open up lockboxes in dungeons and adventures. Veteran dungeons and adventures. This was something I was personally really hoping NCSoft wouldn't include in the way to free-to-play, and a lot of people looked at me and go, dude, you're delusional. Of course NCSoft was going to say, Carbine, this is what we're going to do to help us keep some income going. You can now have these keys and the fortune coins and the service tokens, and you can keep the money going. So these keys open up lockboxes. If you know what the Black Lion market box, whatever it was, the Black Lion key, that would open that. In Wildstar's case, lockboxes only drop off from what I've been told the last boss of an encounter of a veteran adventure or dungeon. And if you don't have a key, it's just going to take up an inventory spot.
Real quick, let me explain why this doesn't matter at all. So we have the coin with the carrot thing. What's the coin called?
The fortune coin.
Thank you, fortune coin. I was going to say lucky coin, but that wasn't right at all.
I've been calling them carrot coins because they're lop.
Done, carrot coins, doing it. That's what I'm calling them from now on.
It's the Tundra Dome and carrot coins.
So you have the fortune coins, which is basically the same thing. You roll on gear. You roll on random gear. And the loot boxes are the exact same thing. You're rolling on random gear. It's just another way to get you to roll on something random. And like keep you gambling, basically. Which is kind of like free-to-play models. One of the free-to-play models' MO for making money is like, hey, you could get something super cool, give us some money. Oh, you didn't get quite the thing you were looking for, give us a little more money. And then you get a little more money. So, like, RNG is kind of free-to-play's best friend. So I think they're just looking for every avenue to add RNG to the game so they can keep people...
Plus, this is also an NCSoft property, and if Guild Wars 2 is doing it, it kind of makes sense that Wildstar would also use it.
You notice players,
get ready for that, too.
They took every single free-to-play monetization model and shoved it into this game.
That's worked or has been successful or failed.
Right. So they took Hearthstone.
They've been doing the good kind. Yeah.
They took Archages, and now they've taken stuff from Guild Wars 2, and I'm assuming a bunch of other games. Like every single Facebook game and all this other stuff, all these
casual
games.
But unlike Archage, you're not forbidden or stopped from doing things just because you don't have like the service tokens. It's, hey, do you feel like spending more money today?
Right.
Go ahead. We won't stop you.
I'm not saying they're bad implementations. I'm just saying all of them are there.
So I have two more points to add to the lockbox system. KDM posted a link from the forum from Carbine Warp Dust, and he says, quote, just to clarify the lockbox system and the gear that can be obtained from it. None of that gear is extra or new. all of the gear can be gotten from a lockbox is already in the dungeon and can be obtained through normal methods and loot tables. The lockboxes are, in effect, another chance for players to earn a piece of gear from that dungeon, but the lockboxes are located at the end of the dungeon, so the dungeon must be first completed, including defeating the final boss fight of the dungeon, before the lockbox will appear. And the second point is, I'm looking at the Cash Shop live on PTR right now, lockboxes can be acquired through Endcoin and Omnibits. So once again, the game still is 100% truly free because you don't have to spend money on the lockboxes. I'm not a fan of the system, but the fact that Carbine is still stuck by their word and has made this game 100% free, I'm okay with.
So, and if I recall, the keys are quite cheap.
40 Omnibits right now, I'm looking at it.
That's right. Not... I got that before level 10. I had like 100 Omnibits before level 10 on a new character.
Yeah.
Well, PTR numbers, first of all, so I'm not going to make any judgment on whether or not the keys cost the right amount. But here's the thing I'll say. That's nice. The dungeon gear is what is in this box. It's not like a random
It's another
gear. Another piece but of dungeon gear from that dungeon's loot table.
What I smell from reading that is... Okay, so you have somebody who needs a specific piece of equipment from some dungeon. Like, it's their best in slot, and they need it before they go on to whatever the next progression thing they want to go on to is. So they do this dungeon, they get to the end, and they don't get the thing they want. And maybe it's their guild, and their guild is doing it for them. So they buy a key so that they can open the box and see if they can get one more chance at getting the thing they need. It's kind of like playing off of their frustration that RNG didn't get them what they need so that they can take another roll at it. Which is smart on their part, and it's not like it's forcing people to spend money, but they are taking advantage of something, and it's clever.
And that's just me pouting and whining and complaining, because I didn't really want that as a player. But it's here, I don't have to take part in it, I can totally just get rid of my lockbox, but I can use Omnicoin, which is Omnibits, which I'm okay with. Sorry
and,
for the confusion on
RNG games. Cav makes the point, and Clover said this originally, is that it's available via Endcoin and Omnibits, so you don't need to spend money on it. But that's the free version of Endcoin, which is Omnibits, is there to make you buy Endcoin. Like, that's the purpose of it. There's no other reason for it to exist.
You really could get this mountain right now.
Yeah, you could get this coin with Omnibits, and then you run out of Omnibits, and you want the next thing, so you're just like, oh, I'll just get a little bit of Endcoin. Like, that's why it's there. So, you're right, it's for those people that aren't susceptible to that kind of thing, it's not a problem.
It's a business move, and you can't blame them for taking it.
I'm not, and I'm saying, all I was saying was that it was clever.
It's just me
I'm not angry about it.
It's me that has
it's just interesting, the psychology behind it, because you know there's a ton of it there.
Absolutely.
Actually, now that I'm thinking about it, the only thing that actually forces you to buy real money right now are fortune coins. That's the only thing in the game you have to spend real money on.
Hearthstone model.
Yeah. So, one more thing before we go into the rest of the PTR stuff, I have a question for you guys. Now that you have access to the Cash Shop and you kind of played around with it and you kind of seen it, is there anything you would strongly recommend players spend their Omnibits on or Endcoin on if they have that ability to as soon as they can? Because I have one thing for just pure quality of life that I think people need to spend Omnibits on.
I know where you're going.
I know exactly what you're going to say.
Do it.
And for me, it's the writing increase.
Oh, it's so cool.
First thing I'm gonna buy.
It's so cool. I know a lot of people in our chat have raided before. We have not. We don't have the money to like get that upgrade. When Indigo and I started, he purchased the upgrade on PTR, and I hadn't. And we raced, and it was just like, and I was just like, nip, nip, nip.
And the fact that you can ride at level 3 now, screw it. Just go into the store, use your Omnibits, buy the riding license. I forgot what the price was. I actually ended up buying it on PTR before the show. Or if you're going to spend any money on the game with Endcoin, just buy the riding increase alone. Don't even worry about anything else, because you'll eventually, by the however much you want to play, you'll be able to get everything else you want via some other means, or you'll eventually get it as well. Also, for one more point of note, the Pristine Key that gives you instant access to Datascape is not on the Cash Shop at all.
Yep. Yet. Not Datascape.
I don't think it will be. I don't think it will be. I don't think it really should be.
For attunement having been simplified as much as it has been, that would just be really sad if it was on the Cash Shop.
I'm curious as to if it's even going to be an item anymore.
It will probably still drop from Omna, and I think they also supposedly drop from Avitus, purely so guilds can give them to alts and be like, hey, we need you to roll a such and such. Here, there, you're attuned. Let's go.
Yeah, right.
You owe us. Here's your key.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's... the dungeons do take a bit of time, but if you're in the situation where you have a guild that wants you to be attuned, they can run you through dungeons in
you could do
a day. Some guilds are really one day. Lazy.
Yeah. Apparently.
Just people are still selling them for 40 plat on live right now.
Why are people buying that? Okay, whatever.
I don't know if people are buying it, but that's what people are trying to sell it for.
And on your comment before we move on, because I've said it like three times, people have been saying that the dungeons are much more convenient to get through. There's a bunch of speed boosts throughout Sword Maiden. All the bosses now have a real nearby hollow crypt, so you can just jump right in the action. People are obviously over-gearing themselves with the dungeons and PTR, so they're just wiping through them. So if you are trying to get attuned really fast with guildmates that are already attuned for GA and Datascape, you really can just spend a night, set it aside, and just blast through the first two attunement requirements. Just done. You really can. It's surprisingly easy. So let's move on and show some of the cool stuff.
Oh, I have one last thing on the cash shop, if I might. Okay, so fortune coins for your little lop lady fortune teller can only be bought with real money. Yeah. But all of the rewards that you get from her, as Cadian pointed out in chat, they are all BOE. So if you get a double, or if you decide you don't like whatever it is you got, it'll be on the auction house. So don't be like, oh, woe is me, I want to play for free and not spend money. If you want to grind that plat and get it off the auction house, someone's going to be selling them eventually.
Yeah. So let's move on. There's a few other cool things. We won't go over everything, by the way, because there's so much that I got dropped over. A good bit of it, though. Challenges are getting an overhaul. So right now on live...
God, I wish you'd go in order. Anyways, sorry.
We did go in order. We kind of grouped everything together for the cash shop stuff. Anyway,
you're right.
Challenges are getting an overhaul. On live right now, if you start a challenge, you have bronze, silver, gold rank, and every time you finish it, you have a chance to randomly roll a few optional things. Sometimes people don't even care about them because they're just meta shots or they're random scavenging stuff that you don't really care about. If you have played in any way, shape, or form the new contract system, that's pretty much what challenges are now. When you go into a new zone, you go into your challenges tab, it'll have a bar. It'll have different marks like tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, tier 4, and then tier 5 max tier. You've done the max amount of points to get it. Every time you complete a challenge and the rank of your challenge, it'll fill up that bar. The challenges are still repeatable, so if you didn't get gold and you need like maybe 100 more points to get to that next tier, you can go back and restart it and you'll get more points for it. But when you do reach a tier and get your reward, you don't get a random chance anymore. You just click, it says, hey, do you want A, B, or C? Just like challenges, or just like contracts.
Yep.
You can hover over it, and then you can click it and hit accept, and now that item is yours.
This whole
system.
Good,
I can finally get my goddamn lop pets that the RNG has not been. I don't know. RNGesus is mad at me. I can't get either of the lop pets right now.
Yeah,
I fail in that role.
I still want the lop from Malgrave, and there's also some really the max. There's like two max bags in the game, in Grimvault and in Malgrave. I think they're like 15 and 17 slot bags that are only available through challenges. So if you really need the max bag space on you, just go into Malgrave and go into Grimvault and just start grinding challenges. And then once you hit that tier. Done. Just grab.
I have the one from Malgrave, but not the other one yet.
Same. I need the one from Grimvault, and then I max out on bags for this point in time.
Have you killed the Vulch in Grimvault?
Not yet.
That one drops a 16 slot unique bag called Carry On Luggage.
That's the greatest one ever.
I love it. I'm going to keep that forever just because of the name.
Someone got paid for that, and they deserve a raise.
Yep. He deserves two raises. So I just want to make this point clear. This is a copy of the contract system, like through and through, and I love it so much because the contract system is great. And I think this was another really good opportunity to implement it, and whoever made that choice has my thumbs up.
There's one thing I am...
And if you suck, you can just keep trying.
Yeah. Challenges themselves, in essence, don't change. It's just what rewards you get from them and how you get them are being changed.
Right. It's great. I love it.
Some people don't like them so much, and I can see why. Some people are okay with the RNG stuff. I think having being able to make that work and actually go through the challenges and pick the rewards you really need is much more... it's better for you.
It's better.
It really is, because you don't
have to... Because if it's not that way, you get a cold... But if it is that way, you're healthy. That's how it works. It's better for you. It's like bacon. Bacon is good for me. Moving on.
Yeah. So, we meant all over the show notes, so I can't tell what I'm doing right now.
Yeah, neither can I.
We're going into housing.
Okay.
Clover, Would you like to take over this part, or are you going to be too excited to contain yourself right now?
Oh God!
Thank you, Wildstar Core, for this video.
Yes.
Oh my God! Seriously, that it was, and thanks to Kelsen, who I think was the one responsible.
Well, it's no life. He's always creating something and housing so amazing. How do you have the time to do this, man? How?
Because he lives on Nexus. He bought an Oculus. He figured out how to transfer himself.
He's in the grid.
Onto Nexus, and he just lives there now.
And his boyfriend's just like, oh my God, I can't get him out anymore. He's lost it. He's in the ether. But he creates amazing housing stuff. So thank you, Kelsen, for the video.
Oh God, where to even start on the new housing stuff? There's a bunch of random new plugs, some of which we haven't even figured out all that they do yet. There's a lot, Treasure Paradise, Marauder Cove, if you want pirates, because who doesn't? There's one with a Pumera mother that you can feed her, and she eventually has babies. We're not sure with what. Apparently, Pumera produce asexually. I don't know. Pappy, can you confirm?
Yeah. Lord drop on Pumera reproductive cycles, please.
No, please. They are, ever since the whole Orin reproductive thing, we don't go there again.
Reproduction.
Lormageddon had some interesting information in it. But no, for new items, probably one of the biggest things that made me like scream really, really loud was you can now have water. There is a winding river and about three different types of waterfalls, and they're animated and they make sound, and I've been dying for these. There's more rope bridges, boardwalks, more
Wizard
stuff.
Guards are in there?
Yes, the guards, which I think only come from the fortune teller. I don't know.
Yes, right now they're only from the fortune teller.
Yeah.
There's a ton more stuff that we haven't said, too. Also, an option for a completely flat and level plot.
Boom. Oh, yes.
Yes! Yeah, now I can start working in housing.
Exactly.
And Celestion Ground, I think, is a new one. There's a new sky in the cash shop, which is...
I think.
It's called Falling from the Sun. Caution to any of you who are prone to motion sickness. You may want to try that right now.
Yeah.
Because
it's so.
I think it moves a little bit too fast.
It's very fast.
Mess you up.
Like, I'm thinking motion sickness and seizures are people who should stay away from that one because it's intense.
Maybe seizures, not so much, but definitely motion sickness.
Warning, you're probably going to see that in this video. I don't know if we passed it or not.
I think if you combine that with like a challenge, like a Katya race track.
Oh, no. Nope,
that
nope.
Would just make it, yeah, heck
absolutely
yeah.
Not. No, I would
not. Someone do it.
Oh, we haven't seen it yet.
There it is, the Pumera Matriarch. Kit. And a Mama Pumera that you feed her, and she has babies.
Oh, have we talked about Osen House yet? That just came up on.
Oh yeah, huh? We get Osen housing before Mordesh and Makari.
But it looks so cool. I don't even care.
But here's the thing: they already have like Osen items on the vendor. There are no Mordesh or Makari specific furniture and stuff. So if we get their houses, we're probably going to get their furniture and stuff. At the same time, Osen House
looks
is a
so
level
good.
6 loyalty reward. I'm only at level 4, I think.
On PTR.
On the PTR. The loyalty rewards, they were kind of... Bardic was on PTR talking to people, saying that some of it hasn't all been activated yet. Like, the titles and the pets and things that people got from being subscribed are not active on PTR yet. So I don't know if where my loyalty is at is actually accurate, but supposedly once you get to level 6, you get this massive freaking Osun house. It's 2 levels. It has like a balcony on the inside. It's
Clover. It's so
huge.
Cool.
Have you guys actually seen
it's
your?
So cool.
Have you guys actually seen your loyalty level yet?
Having emotions.
Guys, look at the inside. It's so cool.
It's pretty sick.
I'm so sorry for the people listening to the audio version of this podcast. The links for all this stuff is going to be in the show notes, so if you want to take
Krug
a look at it.
Krug is watching a video of this house and just, like, losing all of his shit.
It's
right
really
now.
Cool.
It's so cool. I'm not even a big housing fan. I'm trying to get into it more to build stuff, but the Osen house interior is probably my favorite so far. I don't even want Makari and Mordesh anymore, because the Osen house is a bar above.
Mordesh is going to be freaking great.
It's massive.
They have, like, a gothic
I would
style.
Like to repeat what Fusspot said in chat. That thing is huge. Holy balls.
Yeah,
I agree.
That sums it up quite well.
There's even more to housing though besides that. There's a mannequin increase. I think you can have like up to 10 mannequins now on your plot. You
yes.
can actually buy increased housing decor limits from the cash shop with Omnibits.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that. So I thought originally, so your limit right now is, oh my god, taking my headphones with you. Jesus Christ. Don't get a cat.
That was the best thing that has ever happened on this live stream. Oh my god.
Hey, I want to see the new house too.
Oh man.
Anyway.
Clover, thank you so much. You just made my day.
What the hell was I talking about before my cat ruined everything?
Housing limits.
Housing limits. Okay, so blah, blah, blah. Current subscribers, or if you bought a box, your limits are 1,000 indoors, 1,000 outdoors. So 2,000 total. For people who are playing for free, I believe is half that. So I thought, oh, you can increase your housing limit if you're free to play up to what people have. Except, no, it's more. You can keep buying them in increments of 500, and the new cap will be 2,500 inside, 2,500 outside. Bye, guys. I'm never leaving the housing sky map again.
Yep. More lighting options, more mannequin options. And wait, wait, wait. Just to be clear about this, I want to add one more thing that will freaking blow your mind because we haven't said about it yet. We haven't said anything about it yet. Neighborhoods aren't in here yet.
Yeah, I know. And they go and I spent like 15 minutes trying to set one up. We're like, how do you do it? We don't get it. And then we looked it up and like, yeah, they're not implemented.
Oh, not to mention
I said it on the show.
The plot itself is bigger. They just added like twice as much on the outside.
Oh, yeah,
so
yeah.
When you go back in on PTR, your house,
it's like 10%
your
bigger.
Plot got like, whoop, it just shrunk a little bit.
Now, I honestly think that those extra like 10-15% increase on the size, I think that's going to be the bleed over when you have neighborhoods. Because there's going to be zones in between what they said so far that the players who are on those edges, they both can manipulate that part and add stuff to it. So no plugs over there, but they can add. Yeah,
right. That's where and
this is confirmed.
Well, everything on here is unconfirmed.
Yes. Well, so, that's not true. But okay,
everything could be gone. They could just say screw this and just get rid of it.
Clover.
Well, thank. Yes.
Can you be in a neighborhood with me so that on the border between my plot and your plot, I can put a row of just the most phallic-looking decor piece that I can possibly find?
Pulsating strain,
like the pulsating strain growth that we were talking about before the stream?
It will be a row of the pulsating strain growth.
You are
that's
It's okay, I don't know how to get it.
For all of his neighbors.
Winding River is now up on the screen, and I think it is the coolest looking thing ever.
Oh yeah, the viney overgrowth stuff, the like, for plants you can put on the edge so it looks like ivy.
Mm-hmm. You were talking about doing a Babylon plot at one point.
Yes, I want to do the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, and the only thing I couldn't figure out how to do is, crap, what can I get that looks like water? Now I can use actual water.
Water. I really hope at one point people can go like full sandbox and create like mini quests in here, because some of the housing plots would be insane. I'm going way off the reservation now.
Yes,
let's move back.
Let us.
So, that's cool piece. We're going to be talking about is costumes. 116 costumes are coming in with this drop.
Yep.
Game update. They're amazing. Some of them you'll be able to get through the cash shop. Some of them you'll be able to get through the fortune teller. A lot of them you can still get in game just by actively questing and getting them like they should be. And same thing I said about, and everything here will be accessible in some way, shape, or form. There are a few of them, I gotta find them, while I'm talking I'll be looking through it, that are Shades Eve themed. And one of them in particular, I am head over heels in love with, because it looks like a cross between Skullomania from Street Fighter and a voodoo shaman from just like voodoo religion. It's so cool! that's like my minor squee. But you see like Osen-inspired gear here, Ichthyen-inspired gear here. There's a bunch of like Fixit style gear here. It's insane. There's more Marauder style gear from like different types of Marauder groups.
This is the coolest sword ever. Sorry, you can't see it yet, but I'm telling chat this is the coolest sword ever.
I'm calling it now that Ichthyen stuff is gonna come from that new zone that's south of Auroria. Guaranteed.
I mean
that sword is really freaking cool. Holy shit.
There's a pair of pistols that look like they're kind of like steampunky, Wild Westy looking that are really sick.
Are the red and
the red
like
tinted gear.
With the red. Yeah, I think those are on that's a cash shop bundle. You can unlock the entire class set of weapons in that style.
I think that's the Rowan they're talking about, if I'm not mistaken, and then the other one's like finger trap or something like that.
Yeah.
And there's like corrupted Elden gear, which is really sweet because we can't dye our weapons yet. You'll be able to have more customizable weapons to your gear. There's, like I said, there's like three different forms of Marauder gear here. It's really sick. There's minor stuff here. There's like a set of armor that looks like it's inspired, very Tank Girl inspired. If you want something more futuristic-y and sleek instead of this kind of like cobbled together mess, there's a bunch of really slick futuristic Tron inspired gear, like Ultron looking gear. It's insane. There's even more like primal looking, like just shamanistic. Boom, I found it. Oh my god, it's like halfway up like this. It's so cool. It looks like a voodoo shaman Skullmania. It even has like the voodoo shaman hat and has a face mask. It's like a robo skull. I want Shades Eve so badly.
It's coming.
So sick.
October will be here before you know it.
I've been so excited for a piece of costuming in this game yet. And when I can dye it, it'll be even cooler.
There's also something that looks like a big wizard's hat that doesn't have a mask attached to it, and I want that.
I have more like Desperado armors going down. This is like the second half of it. Even better.
What the fuck is this, dude? What the fuck is this? What's the villain's name from The Little Mermaid?
Ursula?
This side blade looks like it has Ursula on it.
What it kind of does. It's really cool looking.
What the fuck is this shit?
It's in the Aethian theme gear.
Look at the. It's on the stream right now. Look at it. It looks like Ursula is on a Psyblade, and she's like, "I'm Ursula."
Though I like that.
That's so weird. I'd never use that. No offense. I just never use that. That's wow.
Are you offended by tentacles, Krug?
No, I'm into tentacles. Don't tell anyone.
Oh, all right. Well,
fetish.
That's cool.
I will not go through everything. Hazmat suits are on here. There's like a lightsaber stand in.
I've been wondering when the hazmat suit could be something you just get.
It's insane. The panda gear is in here.
Oh yes, the robot panda suit. I need it. I need it so bad.
Oh, these are, I found the steampunk guns you were talking about. These are super cool. They are super cool.
Yeah, I think those are gonna be only on the cash shop.
So I posted the link to all this. I think we should move on since the audio people are getting bored. So let's move on to the next thing.
We'll have links and stuff.
Yeah, links and stuff. Go look at them. They're all super. Super interesting. I haven't even gotten through all of them yet. There are literally 116 images in the imager link I posted. So go take a look.
It's all pets. I think there are 36 confirmed pets for a game update. The next game update coming in. Obviously, you've seen some. You've seen the war pig. You've seen the furlope that they showed off with the China thing. There's a corrupted Elden one that's really cool. There is one that I think is probably their best. Everyone's like, Minimon's so cute. Heck no. Lil Beast is amazing. When you see
Minimon is pretty great though, because it shoots up and flies.
Animations of these guys are awesome.
Minimon looks like it's just learning how to fly, which is why it's so adorable.
It's pretty cute, not gonna lie. More strange stuff. There's a Shadeling pet.
Furlope's adorable. Lil Beast. I don't think Lil Beast is adorable.
You shut your whore mouth.
I don't think it has a purple mouth. I'm sorry, it has a purple tongue, a green mouth, and it's wearing a luchador mask. Like, what is adorable about this?
Because it's wearing a luchador mask.
No. The friendly furlope is hands down the most adorable pet. You're all wrong.
Little beast right here. I will fight you to death for. You know what?
Fight me to death? Are you an idiot? Like, what's wrong with you?
I'll fight you to the death for that. If you are listening to this show, # Team Minimon or Team Little Beast. I didn't see this happen.
I like how you didn't include my entry, but go fuck yourself. I didn't expect you to, anyways. Ooh, Golden Dawngrazer
pet. Already on live, I can tell you that, but I think this list was put together very, very quickly. More Chupacabras, Stumpkins. More Chua enhanced animals.
What is this?
Give me the Dawngrazer.
What the fuck is this shit?
I want the Dawngrazer as a mount.
More skin creatures.
The Shadeling pet looks like snot.
Yes, it looks like Slimer. It's got legs, though.
No, it doesn't. Oh. It looks like somebody took a booger out of their nose every day for 20 years and made a sculpture out of them. That's exactly what it looks like.
That is a very specific description, Krug. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Much more vile, but I'll leave it there.
Audio people, this link is also in the show notes. Take a look at all the pets.
Yeah, we have one more.
You should be watching live.
Right? Yes,
Sunday, 5 p.m. PDT. So we have two more things we want to go over before we kind of close out the week and we talk a little more about it. And we have actually something special from our friends at Wildstar Core they gave us. We'll tell you at the end. So we found out when KDM was on the show that ship hands are going to be renamed. They're going to be called expeditions. And accordingly, anything called an expedition in-game will have a slight name change to it, so it's a little more streamlined and non-confusing for players. Mm-hmm. Expeditions, all the current ones, are going to get the They Came From Fragment Zero treatment. They're going to get some form of cutscene and or outro and or intro. Not all of them are getting the same thing, but Wild Wii was able to do a quick run-through of each of these expeditions and slow down and wait and pause and give us the audio when the cutscenes happen. The in-game cutscenes are kind of more flavor, and they kind of give a little more cinematic feel of it. Like, this thing has alien creatures. Go kill them all. They're here to kill you. The outros have a very Twilight Zone of Outer Limits sci-fi B-movie feel to them. Like, this is the end. Or is it? It's really...
It makes it more fun and playful. And we are here to have fun, lest we forget.
And be playful.
Exactly. Even at its darkest, also super dark, but the expeditions are the really fun bright spot. Like, they totally embrace the campiness that is sci-fi. I mean, heck, you have Rage Logic, which is just kill a bunch of like crazy rapid robots. You have obviously
Space Madness. Space Madness,
which is
and the Gauntlet, which is amazing. I still suck at exploding Splorgs every time.
Really? I've never once died at the Squirgs.
I haven't died from them, but I've come very, very close, and my guild doesn't want to run that ship hand with me if they can help it.
So it's really fun. Cadium, since you are on the expedition team and everyone else working on them in the cinematics team, thank you very much for putting a little extra love and care into it. We haven't talked about everything that's happened in PTR. We'll probably go over more as we find them in the coming shows.
Not even close. We just can't make a 4-hour-long podcast.
Yeah, we're going to keep it a little over an hour.
You guys need something to talk about next week. So.
Exactly. So a few things we've learned while leveling in PTR. So Clover, you have the first part because you actually saw this and talked about it yourself.
One of the first things you're going to get, and I can't remember if I got it on the ARC ship or when I landed, was the Protostar's Revolutionary Rucksack. It's a purple item. You're basically going to keep it throughout all of your leveling. Starting at level 1, you can open it and you get a basic shirt and pants that you can equip that actually have stats on them. Open it again at level 5, you get a 6-slot bag and some, I keep wanting to say potions, they're meta shots in this game. Level 7, you can PvP at level 6, and level 7 actually gives you some PvP headgear and a mount license for free that you can just use. And you keep getting stuff like that as you go. You'll get a handful of flasks, things that will reset your rest XP or give you XP gain or more currency. A few of the one-use items, which I believe you can get off of the cash shop, think, like summoning the bank or the rune crafting station. That's just a one-use thing.
The pots for sure you can get from the cash shop. The vouchers for the bank and everything else, I haven't seen anywhere else but the rucksack.
And you'll get both PvE and PvP weapons, and it's about every 5 or so levels from like 10 to 30. And then eventually at level 50, you will get one lockbox key and the Corrupted Elden Probot pet. So that's like, hey, congratulations, you're level 50. Here, have a pet.
I'm a little torn on the rucksack. I like the fact that it's a lot of convenience items, but then when it gave you actual gear with stats on it, I was a little torn on it. I don't think it's not, you don't have to pay for it, so it's not buy to play at all in any stretch of the imagination. It just feels odd that you would get free weapons essentially instead of saying like, hey, here's a voucher. Instead, go to the PvP guy in your zone and see what you can do about it. I mean, it's the same virtual thing, but it's bypass the middleman, I guess. I just think giving the weapons with stats is so odd to me. I don't know how I feel about it yet. Same thing with the pots. Like the pots, some people are arguing that the XP pot is power creep. The drop percentage. I didn't see the percentage drop pot for like items. I didn't see that yet. I could be wrong. People were curious about that, and they're kind of torn about that. People giving pots for extra reputation and renown and glory. They're a little torn on the pots. I'm a little torn as well personally. I don't know how you guys feel about it.
It's funny, when I was on PTR and we were talking, Bardic was there asking, mostly she was there fixing people who were supposed to have end coin to test out the shop and didn't have it. She was busting her butt for that for quite a while. Was also curious to say, hey, so what's on the cash shop that you guys like? And 90% of the answers were essentially, oh my god, dies, oh my god, pets. Well, no pets yet, but they want them, and oh my god, mounts. No one really seemed to care about the flasks. Now, granted, these are just the people who actually answered. Who knows what that's going to be when you open this up to potentially who knows how many more people when it's free, but people seem to be far more interested in the cosmetics than the stuff that's actually going to get you currency or whatever else.
Yeah. So, I don't know. I think the flasks can be very useful, and I'm going to say this for the next part. I found out when I was leveling through as in PTR. Like I said, Omnibits, to me, seem to have a 10% chance of dropping from mobs. I've roughly counted it every somewhere between 7 and 15 mobs I would get an Omnibit. And it wasn't exact, it would just tend to be around that general time frame. Sometimes I'd get one of them one immediately after. Sometimes I'd have to kill like 20 things, 25 things before I got an Omnibit to drop. And Wildstar Court does say, hey, we have some more information about the cash shop. We'll put the link in the description as well. Man, they don't seem to drop, I said, from task quests, so don't bother. And if you want to be a completionist, do the task quests because they're fun. They're less important to the overall progression of the story. But I did tend to see them drop occasionally from region and zone and world quests. So I don't know how consistent they're going to be on that, but I did.
I can say I had about 100 Omnibits by the time I hit level 10.
Yeah, so. I was surprised at how fast it was happening. Even at a 10% drop rate, roughly, it seemed to be pretty fast. And I agree, I had close to about 100 by level 10. Holy crap, though. The reason I talk about flasks is that flasks, the experience gain flask and the rest and relaxation flask, which actually resets your rest XP bar, broken in like the greatest way, because I instantly, once I got access to one of them, I popped the 50% XP gain, and then I instantly popped the rest XP gain when I got to new level. I was always 2 to 4 levels above the most recent quest I got.
Leveling alts, that's gonna be pretty freaking great.
And that's on top of the signature status XP boost as well. If you want to alt level at this moment, from free to play, it's going to be insanely fast.
Is the signature status boost on PTR? Because I don't think PTR recognizes signature yet, because they keep asking me to buy it.
Exactly.
And
but
I think
if you go to your,
that system doesn't exist yet.
That's the weird part. I can't tell if the signature status is kicked in yet, because you're right. In the cash shop, it does say, hey, go signature, which is weird. So I'm like, I thought I already was. But I go to my accounts, and it says your account unlocks. Oh, yeah, you have signature status. You get these bonuses. So
yeah,
I was a little
confused. I'm not sure what's
that.
Up with that yet.
And on top of that, I didn't see any quest breadcrumbs that led you to the next zone or the next major hub relevant to your level. So I guess that'd be kind of hard to do considering people are just kind of just blazing through leveling at the moment. But I would hope that when you get to like the minimum level to get into the next zone, if you're power leveling, you would just get a quest that says, hey, you know, get to Elevar or get
to
Wilderun.
How high level did you get on PTR?
Right now, I think I am level 14 and I'm questing like level 9 quests.
So 14, it didn't give you anything to, like, hey,
sorry,
13. Oh, okay. Because 14, I think, is when they yell at you, like, hey, this is your city. You should go look at it.
Yeah. So I haven't gotten that yet. I wonder how it's going to be. Honestly, I think I was talking to Moose about this because he was kind of sad about how fast I was blazing through the early levels. My thought is this. Levels 1 through 25 are going to be a blur. You're going to zoom through them. And I can't say for
sure. Good, because if I have to do Galeris one more time, I'm going to lose it.
But, see, Glarus wasn't an issue for me. My issue as a person, as a player, with my personality, was Wilderun and White Veil. So that XP boost in those pots and those flasks are going to be a godsend once you hit 30 to 50. People have been saying repeatedly, it depends on the player, they hit this pocket of grind. And not just normal grind, like super slow down grind. Because
Wilderun had a case of Stranglethorn Veil.
Yeah, so many quests, and not a lot of holo XP between all the quests, so you're just...
And hunt all the things.
Hunt all the
things. 20 of all the things.
Hey, I don't know the answer to this question. I'm wondering if either of you do, since I don't think we talked about it. Is cred still going to be a thing?
Say again?
Is cred still going to be a thing?
Cred is still active.
And it's just going to work as plat
It'll
for 30
be...
days of premium?
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll pay...
Your signature service can be maintained with cred or credit card.
And every time you get cred, you get loyalty points.
And it's the same, like, increased percentage of cost for buying a premium month to sell. So it's $20 instead of $15.
It's still $20, yes. It's okay. Always a little more
because,
than month.
Because the cost of signature is still going to be $15,
right.
Like the subscription is now.
Correct.
But again, it can be a truly free-to-play game, even with signature service if you're still grinding cred.
Yeah.
So, Durukai asks, are Omnibot drops in dungeons and raids? I have not... Omnibits. I haven't had a chance to go in a dungeon or a raid yet, so I can't tell you for sure if Omnibits are dropping. I would definitely be certain they would. My assumption is, yes, they're going to drop. How much? KDM actually clarifies this. Omnibits drop off things that give you experience. So, yes, basically, they're going to drop in dungeons and raids.
So, there you go. If it gives you experience, you're going to get Omnibits.
Are you sure things in dungeons give you experience?
Yes.
Are you positive?
If they're...
Yes.
Oh, are you okay. Sure? Experience, like, say if you're capped at 50 and you're fighting level 50 things.
I was joking.
As long as the level's not grayed out. Well, some people may not know what you're talking about. Some people so I'm going to clarify because I'm nice.
So another note I noticed was there's more neutral enemies now instead of outright hostile enemies at lower levels, which is kind of interesting. I thought that was just an odd change. I did notice that a lot of the primes were moved out of the way or not where I thought they would be.
Yeah, that change I totally forgot about until I got into PTR.
There were like, a lot of things that I'm like, wait, isn't this supposed to aggro me right now?
Yeah.
No? Oh, okay.
Anyway, Clover and I made the same thing, the same mention in that quests are streamlined to hell and back. A lot of them are streamlined. Like, it's a quarter or a third of what you used to have to get to complete the quest, or it's changed fundamentally.
Some have been cut out completely.
Yeah. Some have been cut out completely to make sure the leveling curve is easier. The bounty board primes, I feel, are easier now, especially at lower levels. Like, as a spellslinger on live, I had trouble with bounty board primes. On that spellslinger on PTR, I'm blasting through them. And I'm not...
I haven't tried any of them yet, because out of habit, I was soloing, so I was like, yeah, not going to bother with that.
I can't tell, and Kaden just says we did adjust a ton of quests and lower level experiences, so you'll notice that change. I can't tell if it's just me as a mechanically better player than at launch, when I was doing this area, but it was definitely less of a hassle. I didn't...
Yeah, that's a thing I noticed. I'm like, oh, am I just better because I know this class, or did things get easier? I don't know.
Also, for those of you that were in beta, and you loved this guy, and he was taken out for the game for good reasons, Mac is back. For those of you who don't know what Mac is, he talked like Mickey from Rocky. And he used to be the skill vendor in WildStar. He had in beta, he had boxing gloves on.
Oh, yeah!
Skills from. Now he's back in PTR. He'll probably be back in live as well. He is the person, this is the cool part, he teaches you right around level 7 how to use your support abilities
before you get into Protostar Academy.
Exactly. So if you're playing a character or a new role, or you have a friend who's learning, oh, I want to learn how to heal, and you're like, well, good luck because you can't level as a healer during the game. Max shows up and he goes, hey, you, get over here, get in this portal. You have a tank ability, right? Well, hop on tank abilities. I want you to do this for me. If you're a healer, I have people dying down here. Hop on your healing abilities and learn how to use them. A whole room you can run around with and try out all your healing abilities.
I never even heard of that.
Yep.
Nor did I see it in PTR. Where do you know where that guy's located? I kind of want to try it. Now,
I'm playing Achua right now. So I found him in Daradun.
That's gross.
I found him in Daradun.
You flea-covered Mongol
basically,
piece of crap.
After you get out of your level... You're in your zone for level 3 to level 6, and as soon as you get out of there and go to your next one, whatever that happens to be for your faction... He'll kind of be right there in that little questing hub and be like, hey, I'll teach you how to do your support thingy. Step on the teleporter. And
that's good. It's good for new MMO people to learn about aggro. Because me, first MMO, or like second MMO, but the first one didn't have a threat mechanic. Threat is really confusing for me. Like when I first started playing, I did not understand threat. I didn't understand that
you
build threat when you heal. I didn't understand that you build threat when you heal. That concept went way past my head until I realized that a threat meter was an important tool. I didn't realize that threat was hard-coded sometimes to latch onto the healer, and I didn't realize that you could accidentally take threat. Like, there's so many things about threat that you don't get. I really hope that those tutorials go over threat for healers. Threat for healers is really important to know.
They do not.
They don't. It just goes over your healing skills.
And I mean, why would it? Because threat's an invisible metric.
The health bar goes up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, okay.
It doesn't go that in depth. Like, how to manage your threat.
That's stupid. Like, now I really want to go try it because it's probably not. Whatever. It doesn't sound useful. That doesn't sound useful. If they went over, like, more advanced.
All those things you actually go over in proto games. Like, hey, you're the healer. Your job is to make sure that you heal people, but don't get the thing attracted to you.
But it doesn't talk about threat in proto games.
It kind of vaguely does.
It does for the tank, doesn't it?
For the tank, but it doesn't. It doesn't apply it to a support role. For the healer role specifically. It just talks about, hey, you're a tank, you need to take the damage, this is how you get things to attack you instead. But for a healer, it doesn't say, sometimes you're going to be the one getting attacked and you have to run away. Or, when you heal, it creates threat.
Well, like, question, if you don't have an add-on, like a threat meter, as a healer, do you know you're generating threat?
No. And that's what I was saying. That's
they're attacking you.
Right when we started talking about it, I was saying, oh yeah, I guess that's an invisible thing for most people, like, that don't use add-ons, don't know what threat is. So, like, no add-ons whatsoever, they can't teach you about threat because you can't see the numbers. So it's not really that helpful.
Yeah. So one more thing before we kind of start logging off for the night. I had to mention there. Oh, your skills. Your skills no longer cost money. They get as you level. You'll get your second skill set before level 10. So you can have your optional offhanded skill set before level 10. And by level 10, all 8 of your ability slots are open.
Yeah.
Which is freaking great.
Yup.
So there's that. It's crazy. It's a lot of crazy changes. It sounds blasphemous when you talk about it now, but going in and actually doing it in practice, I'm totally cool with.
Because new people are going to want to come and be like, oh man, all these cool spells. What does this do? What does this do? They get familiar with the limited action set and actually want to play with different skills because they're not like, oh crap, I gotta save up 2 more gold before I can even buy this thing. Do I need it? I don't know.
From what I can tell too, Mac doesn't seem to close when you use after you go into his quests. So if you're still a little confused on like what spells can be healing spells or like what spells will give you shield and what spells can damage and heal, you can still go into Mac's room and kind of mess around a little bit. I could be wrong. It could change. I
didn't try going back in after I finished it, so I'm not sure.
I believe I was able to, but that could be a bug. So if you're listening, Carbine, you may want to double check that to make sure. Hey, I'm not on the forums at the moment, so this is our way to show our grievances. So
now I still have to file a bug about breaking the hollow wardrobe.
So my door is knocking. So I think we're gonna have to start wrapping this up. But I will say, Wildstar Core and Cav gave us something.
Oh yeah, today. What we're the fuck are you talking about again?
Like we got a thing apparently.
We got. So
we'll edit that maybe.
It's all right. I have the door locked, so because typically my little one will walk into the room. An adult needed to get in, so I had to unlock it. That's what happened. Anyway, let's get back on. Cav and Wildstar Core gave us a present, and you know how we love doing things on the seat of our pants because it makes it easier for us in our job. First off, thank you, Cav, and thank you, Wildstar Core, for these. I have 4 codes for things. Do you know what those things are?
No.
Do I get one?
I wanted to claim one for myself, but there's only 4, and I have to be fair, and I have to be
good. Ah, bugger.
2 NA codes and 2 EU codes for Gamescom items.
Ooh, Clover, you do not get one.
No.
So unfortunately, you're on the show, so to be fair, this week you cannot claim any of these codes. Another week, possibly, but this week, no. We have to figure out how we're going to give them away. We obviously can't give them away right now on stream, or can we?
We could.
We'll throw this part out in just a little bit. And if you're listening to the audio, check us out on Twitter. You find me at DocQT at Twitter. And Krug, where can we find you?
You can find me at KrugQT, also on Twitter.
And Clover, where can we find you?
You can find me at CloverWS, Clover spelled with a K.
Yeah. Especially check out Doc and Q at QTimes and KrugQT because we're going to explain how you can get these codes.
Yeah.
For episode 57 of Strange Tales from Outer Space, my name is Doc and I have with me Krug.
I'm Krug.
And Clover.
Hey!
You guys all have a good time. We'll see you next week.
Bye. Hello, everybody. Thank you for watching the video. If you liked the video, please feel free to like the video and subscribe to the channel for more videos. Also, please check out the annotations below for more videos. Bye.